Going to go right into it. Jason.
Thanks, Ike. Welcome, everybody. Welcome to BSD versus GPL. Personally, I'd like to thank the organizers and the volunteers making the New York City BSDCon possible, and my employer, OmniTI, for sponsoring my talk. I had to get that in. A couple years ago, I was invited to give a talk here that was quite a lot of fun to give and seemed to be well received. Unfortunately, they were foolhardy enough to invite me back again. But as we know, sequels rarely measure up, so the official title of this is not the sequel to BSD is Dying. But don't worry, it's just as short as the first one. BSD versus GPL, the great debate. The ongoing conflict between users of the BSD and GPL licenses. But what is the debate? Do you mean like, gosh, Jason, I didn't know there was a debate between the BSD and GPL licenses. Or like, duh, Jason. Everyone knows that BSD has already won. Well, for the sake of argument, let's assume that we're talking about the former. So back to the debate. Which license is more free? It depends a lot on how you define freedom. Is it a tool used to guarantee the freedom of the code for everyone? Or is it a mechanism providing select freedoms to a select group of users? I'll let you make that judgment for yourselves. But first, let's step back in time a moment and look at the origins of the BSD and GPL licenses, which should help us better understand their goals and philosophies. I know, boo. Even though work on the ancestors of Unix dates back to 1974, it took roughly 15 years to get to a point where these licenses became a necessity. Back in 1985, Richard Stallman, a member of the staff at MIT, had a dispute with a company named Unipress. Another developer named James Gosling had developed the first version of Emacs written in C. After Stallman had incorporated parts of Gosling's Emacs into GNU Emacs, Gosling sold the rights to Unipress. Unipress threatened Stallman against further redistribution of the Gosling bits. So he rewrote the affected portions and released a new version under a copyleft license called the Emacs General Public License. The June 1988 issue of the GNU Bulletin first mentioned the GNU General Public License. But even then, this earliest announcement foreshadowed an underlying theme that forms the Great Debate. Switching gears, we find ourselves in the summer of 1989, soaking up the summer rays in the computer lab of CSRG at Cal Berkeley. The Berkeley software distribution already had thousands of copies distributed to users. Because the releases included the source code to AT&T's Unix, as well as Berkeley's improvements, users were required to purchase an AT&T source license. Demand had built up for a version of BSD Unix that didn't require an AT&T source license. So BSD developers were able to put together a release free of AT&T code that included the BSD-originated TCP/IP networking stack and its supported utilities. This version was officially known as Networking Release 1, or Net 1, and was released under a liberal license where the user could redistribute the code, modified or unmodified, in source or binary form with no accounting or royalties to Berkeley. Even with these liberal terms, hundreds of organizations stepped forward to pay the $1,000 fee for copies of the official Net1 media. By 1991, the free software community had considerable momentum. With the success of the GNU compiler collection and userland tools, Berkeley's own networking release 2, GPL version 2, and the lesser general public license, and the Linux kernel, a fledgling knockoff of Minix, created by a student at the University of Helsinki. Come 1992, and the BSD community was buckling up for a wild ride. Unix Systems Laboratories, a subsidiary of AT&T, filed suit against BSDI, claiming that their derivative of Berkeley's Net2 infringed on the official AT&T copyrights. By 1994, the lawsuit was settled, largely in favor of BSDI and Cal Berkeley. But the impact of BSD adoption was already substantial. Hello. New users gravitated to the Linux and GNU alternative in droves, resulting in increased acceptance of Stallman's GPL license and GNU manifesto. With a little bit of our history under our belt, we can begin to take a deeper look at the goals of each license and the means it uses and the means it uses to reach those ends. Certainly these two licenses share some common goals. They're both OSI approved licenses and suitable for a variety of software projects. Both licenses require attribution to remain intact, typically in the form of a copyright notice within the license. Every developer reserves the right to point at completed works and take credit for their efforts. Admittedly, some may choose not to. We don't have any MySQL developers in here. Okay. Both licenses can, what?
There is.
Oh. Both licenses convey freedoms to the user to use the code as he or she sees fit, to read and learn from the code, use the resulting binaries, develop your own applications, and stick it to your favorite three-letter agencies. Both licenses allow the user to redistribute source code in binary forms, provided certain conditions are met, and we'll come back to this in a few moments. Both licenses provide some basic disclaimers as a layer of protection for the developer against claims of liability for any direct, indirect, incidental, exemplary, that's a really hard one to get a picture of, or consequential damages. Included but not limited to procurement of substitute goods or services. Loss of use. Loss of data. Loss of profits. Or business interruption. I'd like to say that I did this slide before this week, but anybody who knows me knows that's not true. As we've seen, both BSD and GPL licenses share some common freedoms, but as we know, the devil is in the details. I'd actually like to ask for audience participation with the following slides. This is my own experiment to help me gauge the community's familiarity with the licenses. I'm going to read off a phrase, and I'd like you all to tell me which license it's applicable to. Okay, let's begin. Freedom for everyone, even businesses.
BSD.
Correct. Anti-capitalist socialism.
GPL.
Thank you. That's correct. Easy compliance.
BSD.
Force code to remain open.
GPL.
World domination.
BSD.
Perhaps free BSD. I'll give you half credit. Shut up and hack.
BSD.
Thank you. Brief and simple.
BSD.
Complex and obtuse. Now, someone, this is not the ASP graph. This is actually something somebody pointed to online, and it obviously represents the word count in each version of the BSD and GPL licenses.
I can't tell, does it actually go down?
The BSD actually goes down as you remove the fourth and third clauses. Yeah. And if it was open BSD, it would be a flat line. So. Take that as you will. I mentioned previously that both include some conditions regarding distribution. This in particular is where we see a real diversion in philosophies. The GPL license includes a number of terms and conditions intent on restricting the sale, use, and redistribution of the affected works. Let's look at a few examples. First, you're allowed to copy and distribute the program's source code so long as you include the copyright notice, a disclaimer of warranty, and any notices that refer to the license. I wasn't sure that anybody would get this. You may also charge a fee for packaging or transferal of the work, or offer warranty protection for a fee. But you may not sell the software. Second, you can copy or distribute any derivative works, provided you meet the following conditions. Any modified files must prominently display notice that the files were changed. It must be licensed as a whole at no charge to any third parties. And if the program reads commands interactively when run, it must display an announcement, including a copyright notice and disclaimer of warranty. Check. Third, you may copy or distribute the program in binary form, provided you meet these conditions. You include the corresponding source code and a written offer, valid for at least 3 years, to provide any third party with a copy of the source code for a fee not to exceed the cost of distributing the source code. There are other restrictions as well, but we've covered the most intrusive ones. The others amount to a pile of irrelevant gesturing. To be fair, the BSD license isn't without its own restrictions. Most of the mainstream BSD distributions, such as FreeBSD, NetBSD, and Dragonfly BSD, prefer the two-clause BSD license for new code. The OpenBSD project goes one step further, using a BSD-like modified ISC license with no extra clauses. But again, even these have a number of heinous restrictions on user freedoms. Here's an exhaustive list of these restrictions. I'll have to get back to this slide later. The more free a license is, the easier it is to comply with. Conversely, the more complex a license becomes, the more likely it is that violations will occur. The Software Freedom Law Center offers legal representation. To free and open source software projects. Their website would lead you to believe that they defend the rights of all free software projects. But a quick review of their press releases shows that every single case they've accepted has been related to the GPL. In fact, many of you may remember last year when one of the Linux Atheros driver developers relicensed Rake Floaters OpenBSD Atheros driver under the GPL, which is fine. But they also removed Rake's copyright and license notification. The Software Freedom Law Center stepped in and convinced the Linux developers to correct their mistakes, but not until a storm of controversy was unleashed, causing hardship among the Linux and BSD communities. Their press release was carefully worded to make it sound like they were vetting the OpenBSD license for compatibility, rather than explaining how the Linux developers had infringed on Rake's copyright. Does anyone else smell something funny? Because copyright and software laws are so complex, a number of myths have cropped up regarding the BSD and GPL licenses. I'd like to conclude my talk by clearing up a few of these. Myth number one. The GPL license is more free. Although it places restrictions on users, the aggregate freedom caused by forcing users to publish their changes results in a greater level of freedom for the whole. Fact, more restrictions always means less freedom. Whether you're the original developer or an end user, the GPL always places additional restrictions on your copying, modification, or redistribution of the affected works. Myth number two, BSD code can be stolen. GPL zealots claim that because a company can take the code and make their changes proprietary, that it somehow lessens the freeness of the original code. Fact. This is complete and utter bullshit. The original code is always as free as the original developer chooses it to be. No evil corporation could subvert the rights of other users to the BSD license code. Myth number three. Richard Stallman is a socialist intent on destroying commercial software companies.
That's true.
Fact. Fact. Richard Stallman is actually a communist intent on destroying commercial software companies. Socialism actually promotes state ownership of means and production. Rather, Stallman believes in a classless state where he makes up all the rules. The end.